sanctuary, and we want them to know that they are an important part of our community. Several years ago, we chose to be radically inclusive and to adopt a multi-generational worship where our services include all family members. And so we welcome all children and youth of all ages. There are a number of announcements included in your order of service today, including the upcoming services for the next several weeks. So please take those with you so you'll have those reminders for the next few weeks and share them with others as well. For those of you who are joining us online or visiting with us today, if you are not already on our mailing list, you can sign up by clicking the link at the bottom of our westsideuu.org website. And for those of you who are here in person, just a reminder, please take a moment to silence all of your devices. Now this morning, our reflection will be given by our guest speaker, Reverend Lora Brandis. Reverend Brandis spends most of her time now as the nanny, Nana, to her 22-month-old twin grandchildren, Rose and James. And she also works part-time as an on-call hospital chaplain and as the part-time faith-forward coordinator for First Unitarian Church of Dallas. Lora is currently enrolled in the Spiritual Direction Formation and Certification Program of Meadville Lombard Theological School's Leadership Institute Growth, Healing, and Transformation. She previously served congregations in Utah, Idaho, and California. Most recently, she was the settled minister for Horizon UU Church in Carrollton, Texas, from 2016 to 2021, and you'll be hearing more about that later. And so now I invite you just to take a nice, big, deep breath. And from wherever you are, settle into this sacred space that we create. And let us worship together as we listen to this morning's prelude, Friend Like Me, performed by Yuki Kumamoto.
Enter into this space made holy by your presence. Enter this sanctuary, claiming it as brave space, a place to bring the whole of your experience with you, a place to share your story and hear others' stories, the losses, the suffering, the painful, the joys, the lessons, the heart openings. Enter this holy and brave space and bring the whole of your experience with you, the fears, the laughter, the uncertainty, faith. Enter this holy and brave space. Bring the whole of your experience with you. Place it on the altar of our shared humanity and watch how love transforms us all. Good morning, and come, let us worship.
The chalice represents the Unitarian Universalist Association, or the UUA, and it's a symbol of the Unitarian Universalist faith. The flaming chalice is a symbol of both the heritage of our past and the light of hope within this church today. Hmm. Our chalice lighting words are for each and for all, and they're by Eric Walker Wickstrom. We light this chalice for all who are here and all who are not, for all who have ever walked through our doors, for those who may yet find this spiritual home, and for those who can't even yet imagine. For each of us and for us all, this flame burns warm and bright. Our opening hymn is number 347, Gather the Spirit, in our gray hymnal. Please stand if you are able and so moved and join our song leader, Tricia Bowes. Join me in our affirmation. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest of truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To seek knowledge in freedom, to work for justice through action, to serve others in community, to the end that all souls shall grow into harmony with creation. Thus do we covenant with one another. You may be seated. And now, please come forward if you're young at heart or would like to have a close-up view of our time for all ages, presented by Nikki Kennedy, our Director of Lifespan Religious Education.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I am so excited to see all of you here today. I'm going to let Caroline help you guys get cushions. Will somebody grab Tricia a cushion too, please? And Sophia, thanks for helping everyone. Hi, Rusty. I see you have your Rubik's Cube. And you have your stuffy. I'm so excited to see you guys today. I just want to say, if you haven't looked in our garden lately, we had some kiddos that helped us plant tomatoes and basil and squash and marigolds. And not only does some of it taste good, it looks good. And if you see some little tomatoes out there in the raised beds, I encourage you guys to try a tomato and even a piece of basil. But those are the only two things in the garden you're allowed to eat. tomato and basil, right, James?
What about green beans?
There's not any green beans yet, but we're growing corn and it's doing really well. So today I brought a book that is very special to me, and it's called There Is No One Else Like You. And I don't know if adults, if you can relate to this, but sometimes I feel like I see somebody doing something or has been had an experience, and I'm really excited and I really want to do it. And sometimes it's hard for me to wait. Do you guys ever have a hard time waiting for something you're looking forward to or that you're ready to have happen? Yeah, sometimes is that hard? Maybe especially when it's almost summer or you're excited about a trip. Thank you, Sophia. We'll clean it up. Thank you. Well, I want you guys to remember that you are you and you're exactly how you're supposed to be. It's okay to be excited about things, but don't miss on what's happening now. So let me share this book with you. In this world, there are more than 7 billion people crawling in the grass like little ants. They walk around, sit down, think of things, then jump up again. They run from here to there and there to here. Some of them know why they are running. Others have no idea at all. They just go with the flow, kind of like we do up here. We just go with the flow. People live in tall towers in the city or in a cottage in the field where the wind is always whistling. Can you whistle like the wind? Ooh, y'all are good wind whistlers. Wow. Some people live on a mountain way up high, or on a boat on a river, or in a tent in the desert, or in the dark, dark woods. You can never find them in places where it is hard to live, where the earth is scalding hot. It's been pretty hot here lately. Or where the water is icy and cold. Can you guys see the water in the picture? Some people try to do 1,000 things at once. Sometimes I'm guilty. They work, they make phone calls, they drive around, they send emails, and they watch the television in the evening. Only at night, when the moon has come up, are they finally quiet. But some of them are even noisy in their dreams. People have strange things on their bodies, a button on the belly, lobes at the ears, dots on the nose. They have fingers that can push and grab and pinch and cuddle. They also have a head. Every once in a while, they use it to think. People come in different colors, shapes, and sizes. They are people with wiggly toes. Can any of you wiggle your toes? Even with your shoes on, can you wiggle your toes? Skinny legs with freckles in the summer or goosebumps in the winter, with short arms or very long ones that can reach almost anything. People wear everything you can imagine, shoes with flowers or even wheels, a coat of wool, or nothing on their arms. Shorts, short pants, or a long dress. They carry boots or backpacks or cell phones and each other now and again. Some of them love hats, caps, masks, or even veils. Others want their head bare in the rain and in the sun. Some people want to be different from everyone else, and others like to be just the same. People are fragile. You shouldn't drop them because we might fall to pieces. They love a little care, food and drink, but also hugs and sympathy, or pay them a compliment. That makes them glow inside. You guys all have great smiles, that's for sure. I saw all of you smile. Some people are always happy, even when it rains cats and dogs, or when their favorite book is lost. Others seem to have a gloomy cloud that follows them wherever they go. Some people are born scared. They shiver when it gets dark. They stay away from roller coasters, and they tremble when dogs approach. Others walk a tightrope while whistling a song. They climb a steep mountain or parachute out of a plane. They seem to be afraid of nothing and no one.
Thank you.
Some people like to roar. They think it sounds better than a whisper. There are people who sing about all the beautiful things to come, and others who still tell stories about the mysteries of the past. People like to say, "I love you," and like to hear it even more. Some people get lost in their own family. They have lots of brothers and sisters and nephews and cousins and aunts and uncles all over the world. They sometimes wish for a little spot of their own. Others live with their mom or dad or with one small granny. They sometimes dream of a big, big family as a cozy circle around them. People believe in different things. Some believe in secret powers or Santa Claus or the beams of the moon and daisies and cows and a heaven full of stars or and nothing at all. Some believe just in themselves, and that's a great place to start. There are nice people, smart people, stubborn people, cranky people, funny people, scary people. There are people who like reading on their belly in the dew, and there are people who are always wanting something else and something new. Most are angry when they lose and proud when they succeed. They are sad when someone dies, and they are glad when they are loved. 7 billion people, like little ants in the grass. But none of them, not a single one of them, is just like any of you. So today and always, we want you to know that we are so excited you are here with us in this community. We celebrate who you are. And I hope you have a great week and continue to have an awesome summer. Thanks for being here this morning.
Good morning again. My name is Carol Kappa, and I'm also one of the pastoral care associates this morning. In our community here at Westside, we try to make time each week for pieces of our lives to share those with one another. And we do this because each person in our community has value. Each person's experience matters. And the pastoral care team is here for you to give a listening ear and reach out to you or someone you think we should know about that is hurting or might be in the hospital, needs a visit, or at home. Members of the team can be identified by the pastoral care team badge that they wear. Please submit your joys and concerns to our team by completing one of these forms that you'll find out at the welcome desk or by emailing us at pastoralcare@westsideuu.org. Or you can contact any member of the team. The current members of our team are Jane Hardwick, Debbie Rake, John Fisher, and myself, and as well as Brenda McKeon, who is rejoining our team. Would those members, if you're here, please stand. Thank you very much. So we share our concerns with one another today, knowing that sorrows come into each person's life, knowing that together we offer comfort. I have a concern from Myrtle McMahon. She shares that this past week she received word that former Westside member Mignon Vogel passed away. She has been going to Pathways Church for a number of years, as that was closer to where she lived, I think out in Hearst. And Pathways will be planning a memorial service for her later this summer. We also share our joys with one another, knowing too that joys come into all our lives, knowing that together our voices can rise in a chorus of celebration. And Myrtle shares that they just spent 10 wonderful days with their family all together. They met for a few days in Seattle and then they got on a Carnival Spirit cruise to visit Alaska. 32 members of her family gathered together, and it was a wonderful, fun-filled trip. And then I have a joy kind of and a concern mixed together to share this morning. We have someone who's been a longtime member, one of the original members of Westside, who found us in 1995, and I asked them when and how did they come about coming to Westside. There was an ad in the paper when Westside was forming, and they met at Orchestra Hall for several years before they moved, of course, to the shopping center and then found our way here. And they were involved in various activities. They served on the board twice. They were involved in an investment group that would get together and talk about investments and how that was going. And then they were very involved with the Samaritan House group and feeding the people at the Samaritan House, serving as usher greeter and just anywhere they were needed. And so now she's moving to Wichita, Kansas to be closer to her son and her grandchildren. Today is their last Sunday here with us, Ginger Courtney. And would you please stand so we can show our appreciation for you. Thank you so much. We're going to miss you very much. So be sure to come and see her after the service, hug her neck, and tell her how much we're going to miss her. Not every joy or concern can be shared openly in the community. Some must be shared eye to eye or simply held in the heart. We further recognize that some do not have voices with which to speak the depth of their pain or the height of their celebration. We make space each week for musical centering, knowing the life and experience of every person matters, and together our lights shine brighter. So as we hold all these joys and concerns among us, both those spoken and unspoken, let us center to number 396, I know this rose will open in your grave.
My name is Tricia Bowes. I invite you to relax your mind and body and join in a time of meditation. It will begin with an introduction before we move into a minute of silence. Our Tibetan prayer bowl will sound to signal the start of your own meditation, prayer, or reflection, and it will sound again at the end. Our introduction this morning is from the book When Things Fall Apart, Heart Advice for Difficult Times by Pema Chodron. Nothing ever goes away until it has taught us what we need to know. Nothing ever really attacks us except our own confusion. Perhaps there is no solid obstacle except our own need to protect ourselves from being touched. Maybe the only enemy is that we don't like the way reality is now and therefore wish it would go away fast. But what we find as practitioners is that nothing ever goes away until it has taught us what we need to know. If we run 100 miles an hour to the other end of the continent in order to get away from the obstacle, we find the very same problem waiting for us. When we arrive, it just keeps returning with new names, forms, manifestations until we learn whatever it has to teach us about where we are separating ourselves from reality, how we are pulling back instead of opening up, closing down instead of allowing ourselves to experience fully whatever we encounter without hesitating or retreating into ourselves. May it be so. Blessed be.
The great end of all the world's faith traditions is to bring the human being closer to the divine by acts of creation and compassion. And in the spirit of generosity, Westside chooses to reach out to our wider community. Our plate offering for July will go to the Texas Native Health, formerly the Urban Intertribal Center of Texas. Since 1971, this nonprofit has provided culturally sensitive community-based services to American Indians and Alaska Natives living in the Dallas-Fort Worth metroplex and beyond. The center serves those who are members of federally recognized tribes. Its services include primary, dental, and behavioral health care. This one-stop location in Dallas also provides a pharmacy, employment and training programs, and a communal center designed as a co-shared workspace to house tribal representatives who perform outreach for North Texas tribal members. Dora Brought Plenty has been coming to the clinic since the 1970s. 21, she was looking to process the experiences she had at a Native American boarding school as a child. Brought Plenty said mental health practitioners she saw before coming to Texas Native Health had not a clue how to teach or treat us. Texas Native Health is her safe haven. Please give generously as you're able to support the vital work of this organization. And now, let us enjoy this musical offering, Que Sera Sera, performed by Trisha Bowes.
When I was just a little girl, I asked my mother, what would I be? Will I be pretty? Will I be rich? Here's what she said to me. Just a child in school, I asked my teacher, what should I try? Should I paint pictures? Should I sing songs? This was her wise reply. Mm-hmm. said,
Doris Day's out there. You know that song. It's a great song. Thank you so much for sharing that with us today. And thank you now for putting into practice the spiritual value of generosity. Our giving connects us to the wider web of our community. And thank you also for keeping your stewardship commitment current to help keep this congregation's important work going. And now, I'm pleased to turn the pulpit over to our guest speaker, Reverend Lora.
First reading is Dwelling in Uncertainty by Margaret Wheatley. Some people despair about the darkening direction of the world today. Others are excited by the possibilities for creativity and new ways of living they see emerging out of the darkness. Rather than thinking one perspective is preferable to the other, let's notice that both are somewhat dangerous. Either position, optimism or pessimism, keeps us from fully engaging with the complexity of this time. If we see only troubles or only opportunities, in both cases, we are blinded by our need for certainty, our need to know what's going on, to figure things out so we can be useful. Certainty is a very effective way of defending ourselves from the irresolvable nature of life. If we're certain, we don't have to immerse ourselves in the strange, puzzling paradoxes that always characterize a time of upheaval. The potential for new beginnings born from the loss of treasured pasts, the grief of dreams dying with the exhilaration of what now might be. The impetus and rage of failed ideals and the power of new aspirations. The horrors inflicted on so many innocents that call us to greater compassion. The challenge is to refuse to categorize ourselves. We don't have to take sides or define ourselves as either optimists or pessimists. Much better to dwell in uncertainty, hold the paradoxes, live in the complexities and contradictions without needing them to resolve. This is what uncertainty feels like, and it's a very healthy place.
Thank you.
Second reading is from Hope in the Dark, Untold Histories, Wild Possibilities by Rebecca Solnit. It's an enormous challenge because in a chaotic world, people need something to hold on to and something to hold them if all is uncertain. If uncertainty is the only certainty, then the uprooted, the fragile, those that crave something to give them meaning in their lives, simply get washed away by the flood and flux of an unsure universe. For them, hope is often found in certainty, not necessarily certainty rooted in a predictable future, but certainty that they are doing the right thing with their lives. Taking power has been the goal at the end of the very straight and narrow road of most political movements of the past. Taking control of the future lies at the root of nearly every historical social change strategy. And yet, we are building movements which believe that to let go is the most powerful thing we can do. To let go, walk away from power, and find freedom. Giving people back their creative agency, reactivating their potential for a direct intervention into the world is at the heart of this process. With agency and meaning reclaimed, perhaps it is possible to imagine tomorrow today and to be wary of desires that it only be fulfilled by the future. In that moment of creation, the need for certainty is subsumed by the joy of doing, and the doing is filled with meaning. So let's make sure you're hearing me okay. Are you good? Good. I like to see the sound guy in the back being happy with with what I'm doing with the mic. Good. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my journey away from full-time ministry and how it thrust me into uncertainty. So 2 years ago, when I decided to leave full-time ministry at Horizon, to have more time with my family, I had no idea that my best friend from college would die from cancer sooner than we expected, and that my ex-husband would die suddenly the night before my planned last day in the office. When I called the board president that morning, she answered her phone by saying, "I didn't expect to ever hear from you again." I told her what had happened and that I would need more time to clean my office. I had one morning meeting and then I would head to my daughter's to sit next to her on the couch while she sobbed. My daughter was 2.5 months from delivering the twins I now care for daily. I know a little bit about dwelling in uncertainty. I'm not saying that I'm always good at dwelling in uncertainty. On the contrary, I would say that uncertainty has been forced upon me by an uncaring universe that has decided it would be good for me to really get this lesson. I left full-time ministry 2 years ago to help my daughter with her twins and to be a caregiver for my friend Carla, who we thought had 3 to 5 years left to live. We were wrong. When she found out she had less than a month left, she burst into tears and apologized to me for being yet another person to die in my life. In a 2-year period, we had lost our oldest daughter, my stepdaughter, our youngest, my daughter, the father of my 2 daughters, and now Carla, from a rare aggressive cancer. I know a little bit about dwelling in uncertainty. I am surrounded by daily reminders of, in Margaret Wheatley's words, the irresolvable nature of life. And as I sit at my desk and write, there is a photo of my 21-year-old self with my friend Carla at the beach. We are waving and making silly faces at our friend who is taking the photo. We are recent college graduates. I'm pretty sure we were certain we were doing the right thing with our lives. That right thing changed as we grew and matured. For me, that right thing changes as I become more aware of what Margaret Wheatley calls the darkening direction of the world today, and what Rebecca Solnit identifies as our chaotic world. She's a writer, historian, and activist, Rebecca Solnit. And she writes this, repeating from the reading, "In a chaotic world, people need something to hold on to and something to hold them. If all is uncertain, if uncertainty is the only certainty, then the uprooted, the fragile, those that crave something to give them meaning in their lives, simply get washed away by the flood and flux of an unsure universe. For them, hope is often found in certainty. Not necessarily certainty rooted in a predictable future, but certainty that they are doing the right thing with their lives." It has been a little more than a year since the Supreme Court overturned the nearly 50-year-old landmark case of Roe v. Wade, which established a federal constitutional right to abortion. The decision triggered abortion bans across the country, and access to essential health care was pushed out of reach for many. You may know that Roe v. Wade came out of the work of the Women's Alliance at First Unitarian Church of Dallas. They began to study the issue in 1969. They invited a volunteer at Planned Parenthood to speak to them on the issue. Inspired by her talk, they decided to form a broad coalition of folks inside and outside the church, which agreed that the existing law needed to be repealed. In 1970, the members of the Women's Alliance voted unanimously to file an amicus curiae brief in support of the Roe v. Wade lawsuit. In a statement issued the day after the decision to overturn Roe, the Women's Alliance confirmed its support of reproductive justice, reproductive rights, and reproductive freedom, citing that abortion is a matter of religious freedom, a matter of equal rights, that it is a human right, and that abortion is health care. The Women's Alliance vowed to work toward reproductive justice and commit to replacing insecurity with safety, fear with acceptance, judgment with love, and shame with compassion. In one of those moments that reminds me to embrace uncertainty and the joy of doing filled with meaning, I found myself at First Unitarian Church of Dallas the morning Roe v. Wade was overturned. I was serving then as a part-time sabbatical minister, a position I did not know would be available when I left Horizon as their settled minister. As happens regularly in my life, I was standing in a place and a time I did not expect to be standing in, on so many levels. It was a Friday morning, the last morning of the church's week-long camp, Some Fun. My grandbabies were out of town with their parents. I had planned to spend some time at the church delivering a brief minister's message to the campers at the end of their week. We knew the Supreme Court decision would be coming soon. It could be that Friday. It might come the following Monday. I had been watching my phone all morning, and as I stood in the church kitchen with the volunteers who fed the hungry campers and provided tangible evidence that our faith is centered in love, I saw the decision posted on the SCOTUS blog. I announced it to the volunteers gathered in the kitchen, all women around my age. We held each other as we cried. I went to the chapel where the campers gathered for morning worship, and I could tell the news had spread. Teenage girls clung to each other with tears in their eyes. We sang, "When Our Heart Is in a Holy Place." And I reminded the campers, echoing the words of the hymn, that our religion calls us to listen for the wisdom in each of us, to listen with a loving mind, and that true power comes when we honor difference, honor all the stories, not just our own. In reflecting back on that moment several months later, one of the members of YRUU, the Young Religious UU group at the church, she acknowledged that the bans and limits on abortion were concerning to her personally, especially as a young woman in Texas. She knew that people of color and those living in poverty would be disproportionately affected. Dwelling in uncertainty. Margaret Wheatley is also a writer and activist. Her work now focuses on developing and supporting leaders globally as what she calls warriors for the human spirit. She, like Rebecca Solnit, advises us to become comfortable with uncertainty. If we see only troubles or only opportunities, she writes, in both cases, we are blinded by our need for certainty, our need to know what's going on, to figure things out so we can be useful. What they are both suggesting seems so counterintuitive. Our brains are designed to hold on to what has just happened, to control and make sense what is always in our immediate past. We are not comfortable with uncertainty because our brains aren't designed for it. Our brains are constantly running simulations of past and future events. This is a capacity that our ancestors' brains developed over time. Thinking about past events created learning of successful behaviors. Thinking about future events and comparing possible outcomes also promoted survival. The brain's capacity to simulate past and future events, so important to our ancestors' survival, now gets in the way of who we are becoming as human beings. Now, I know I'm not the only one who finds myself repeating a failed past event or conversation or mistake over and over again in my mind, or imagining a possible future conflict, maybe, with all the possible outcomes. As we replay past events, neural associations between the event and the painful feelings are strengthened. The brain's capacity to simulate experiences takes us out of the present moment. The brain's capacity to simulate experiences reinforces our need for certainty. Wheatley advises that we hold the paradoxes, live in the complexities and contradictions without needing them to resolve. Solnit advises that we let go, walk away from power, and find freedom. In the moment of creation, she writes, the need for certainty is subsumed by the joy of doing, and the doing is filled with meaning. So I know a little bit about dwelling in uncertainty. We all do, now that we've come through a global pandemic together. At the end of March 2020, after we had closed the building and moved worship services to online only, I visited Horizon to get some things for my office that I thought I might need for a few weeks. A few weeks. We didn't understand anything in those first few months, did we? One of the books I picked up that day in March, that day that seems like a lifetime ago, was the Pema Chodron book, Living Beautifully with Uncertainty and Change. I knew I would need it for this particular journey through uncertainty. It became a sort of Bible for me during those ever-shifting, never-certain times. This quote became a sort of mantra for me. Our wish for all beings, including ourselves, is to live fearlessly with uncertainty and change. The compassion and kindness required for this are limitless. But we start with whatever we have right now and build on that. Compassion and kindness are required if we are to live fearlessly with uncertainty and change. Now, I will tell you, I rely a lot on Pema Chodron to help me with uncertainty and change. And so I really appreciated the meditation this morning from her book, When Things Fall Apart. That day at the end of March when I naively went to the office to grab just a few things for just a few weeks of staying home, I walked Horizon's labyrinth before I drove home. So it could have felt like just any other spring day that I had experienced at Horizon. The killdee pair, the birds that came every spring, were out with their annual nest in the community garden and had their eggs there. And if you got anywhere near them, they would yell at you. And I wasn't even that close to them when I was in the labyrinth, but I could hear them yelling. And that was really the only sound I heard. There was no other staff, no other volunteers. The church rented to two homeschooling groups. They weren't there. That quiet was the evidence that everything had changed. When I got to the center of the labyrinth, I paused to pray that the pandemic would pass from our lives soon. See that I prayed naively. I have a new mantra now, given all that has passed in that time, one that also comes from the work of Pema Chodron. It's shorter and easier to remember. Pema Chodron teaches us to develop an open awareness and a sky-like mind. Whenever I find my thoughts racing ahead to the next moment, figuring out what comes next, I stop and I say to myself, wide open sky mind. Wide open sky mind. It is how I encourage myself to dwell in uncertainty. We can hold the paradoxes, live the complexities. We can. We can let go of our need for certainty and experience the joy of living life fully into the mystery of what comes next. May it be so, and amen. And I will ask you now to rise in body or spirit and sing a hymn that I'm going to tell you the number of. 344, A Promise Through the Ages Ring.
The first three verses.
As you go out from this place, remember that always, always something sings. Always, always something new is coming out of this time of uncertainty. We can find the joy in the doing. Go in peace. Blessed be.
Flame is extinguished, but not our hope for the future, our courage in the face of crisis, or the love we share in all the world. Don't forget to be back next Sunday when our beloved minister, former minister Russell Ellison, will be sharing a reflection, videoed and taped, but he will be here after the service to live via Zoom. All right, join me in the congregational closing. Go in peace seeking justice. Go in peace committed to equal rights and opportunities for all. Go in the peace that is created when together we build communities of truth, solidarity, deep compassion, and fierce, unrelenting love. Go in peace. May it be so. Blessed be you.